So what makes us opinionated? It is prejudice. Something which makes us have opinions. Something which makes us like or dislike somebody or something without actually experiencing that person or interacting with that person. We make opinions. It's our prejudice. We have never ever met the people, those who live to that side of the border. Maybe Pakistanis or maybe Chinese, right? But we have some certain opinions about them. Yes, our soldiers, the army is doing its job. They are defending our country. They are standing at the border. They are like there. All defense system, it's working at its own pace. Because that is must. Because if you want peace, you must be prepared for war. Yeah, it's okay. In order to maintain that peace, that much of defense system is to be efficient. Okay, no doubt about that. Okay, wherever the system was, the defense was poor, we have seen in Taliban what happened. So defense system has to be the strongest one in the country. That only can ensure peace in the country. Not only here, it's also there. So I was talking about like what makes us prejudiced, what makes us opinionated. The moment we talk about Pakistan or China or any country, especially some countries with which we had, with whom we had really very good relations once upon a time. We were one, of course, before 1947, we were one. But now we have certain prejudices against some countries. We call them as our enemies. Are those people the ones whom we know? Did we ever meet them? Did we ever meet them? Did we ever have a talk with them? Did we have any experience with them? But we are prejudiced. We have certain opinions about them. Like they are like this, they are like that. So that defines our behavior towards them. Okay, so that is enemy. So how we must deal with our enemies, this chapter is about that. How the enemy should be treated. Is humanity our enemy? The answer is a big no. Right? So this chapter actually has been written in the backdrop of Second World War. Second World War, which took place somewhere in 1940s. You know, what was the exact duration of the Second World War? Come on. When did Second World War take place? It started from 1939 to 1940s, 44 or 45. Okay, during this time, you know, almost, because it was a world war. But world war always starts from one particular place. And one of those important, you know, incidents were in Japan, the bomb explosion on Hiroshima and Nagasaki. Okay, this was one of the most disastrous or destructive incident of Second World War. So where are Hiroshima and Nagasaki? Japan. And this chapter also takes place in Japan. The setting of this chapter is also in Japan. So the America blasted Hiroshima and Nagasaki. Up to what extent this incident was destructive or disastrous, we know this till now. Still the after effects of that bomb blast is not over. Till now. Still Hiroshima and Nagasaki are suffering the consequences of that explosion. So you can imagine up to what extent Japan might have been hurt by that incident. The one which did this, can they forgive that country? No, no, of course, no. So it was during that very time when Japan was, you know, already undergoing the consequences of that incident when this incident happened. So in this story, we are going to talk about Dr. Sadao, who is a pure Japanese. What do you mean by a pure Japanese or a pure Indian? What do you mean by this? Somebody for whom the culture, or you can say the values of that country, are very dear. Okay, somebody for whom that culture is very important. That person is pure, pure in race, pure Indian, pure Japanese. So this Dr. Sadao, the main protagonist of the story, Dr. Sadao, his wife will also be there, Hana. And they have, Dr. Sadao's father is not there in the story. He is no more, but still he is present in the story. We read about him in the very beginning. And it is Dr. Sadao's father only who made what Dr. Sadao is today. Dr. Sadao, you will talk about him as a great doctor, as a great scientist, as a great patriot, but in the end, as a great human being. So how he became all this? Because of his father. The chief concern of Dr. Sadao's father was the education and upbringing of his son. He never ever played with him. He never ever cracked jokes with his son. Because there is some reference to parenting also. What kind of parenting should be there, which helps in making the child? Okay, parenting is just not about kidding and making children eat and drink and that's it. Parenting is also making children what the child should be actually. So the father made sure that his son became a complete human being, and that he is. So Dr. Sadao Hoki, his wife Hana. So Dr. Sadao went to America for higher education. There he did his doctorate and all. So there he met Hana, but before he fell in love with Hana, he made sure that Hana was also Japanese. Okay, they came back to Japan. With the blessings of father, he married Hana. If father might not have agreed, then he might not have married Hana. Because his father, the kind of parenting his father had given him, that was enough for the son to live his life with those ideals with which he had been groomed up. So, okay, he married Hana and all. Father was no more now, but this Dr. Sadao became a great scientist. And now he was working upon the discovery of medicine upon the wounds. In those times, many people used to die of infection in the wounds. Okay, antiseptics were not there, you can say. So the treatment of wounds, it was rendered by, the discovery was done by this Dr. Sadao. Okay, so he was in the army, Japanese army. So whenever there is a war, then all the people, you know, all whosoever is in the army is sent to war, you know, is sent with troops to war. But Dr. Sadao was not sent. There were two reasons. What were they? First reason was, like, Dr. Sadao was already working upon the discovery of medicine to work upon wounds. Second reason was that Dr. Sadao was treating the Japanese army general. The army general, you know, he was suffering from a disease, and the treatment of that disease was with Dr. Sadao only. So Dr. Sadao was treating the general of the army. So general of the army might need the doctor at any time. So he did not send him to war. What was the another reason? Why wasn't he sent? Because he was working upon the discovery of that healing of the wound. Got it? Two reasons were there. He was not sent. At this time, when this, I've already told you the background, Second World War, the bomb explosions at Hiroshima, Nagasaki. The kind of mentality the Japanese might have against the Americans, that you already understand. So at this point, when the American enemy, when the American soldier, try to imagine, if the enemy, if your enemy, supposing you are Japanese, if the American enemy comes and comes near your house in a deadly condition, when he's almost about to die because of some injury, what will you do as a Japanese patriot? And you know that very recently these people have been very, very disastrous with your own country's Hiroshima and Nagasaki. What will be your reaction towards that American enemy? Give answer. What will you do? Yes. What will you do? You will not treat him how? You will not treat him nicely. Yeah, okay. He says you won't treat him nicely. Why won't you treat him nicely? Because that person's countrymen, that person's dictators did something havoc with our country. This is what you will do. This is what common man would do. Okay, this is what a person with prejudiced mind will do. This is what we were talking about. Prejudice is what? Having opinion against somebody or about somebody without actually understanding somebody. The point why I'm saying it is prejudice, because this American particular soldier, the one who has come to our home, was it the one who dropped that bomb? Did he do that? Then why should we punish him? Why should we punish him? Because we are prejudiced. We are prejudiced against the whole race. One person did something, we become prejudiced against the whole race, all people. If somebody does something wrong, we are there to tag the person, it's a Hindu or it's a Sikh. This is what we do. Is this kind of prejudice? And this kind of prejudice is only the root of all problems. The moment we will become unbiased, fair, unprejudiced, 100% problems will get uprooted. Everything will be sorted out. 99% problems, you know, they are because of our prejudice. Like, because this person is this, that's why this. Suppose it is not there, then everything will be fair. Then only we can talk about a fair system in the country. Okay, believe me, you think about anything, whatever is going on wrong in the country, except corruption. How many people fight against corruption in the country? Is there ever a andolan against corruption in the country? Never. Is there ever a protest against, all roads are broken in the city? Do people carry a protest against all these things of that level? So when we will think about the progress of our country, prejudices should be kept aside. This Hindu, this Muslim, this Sikh, in the end, we are all one. Actually, we are all one, living together, but even then, prejudices, they are killing us. So one of the greatest, powerful, very influential person said once upon a time, like India is one of the biggest economy in the world. But the weakest point about India is the people are prejudiced. And that weakness will keep on killing India within itself. And that is happening. So prejudice is the biggest, enemy, basically. But we people consider that person is our enemy or this person is our enemy. It's no one actually prejudice. Enemy is the prejudice. So let's see the story. Let's read it out. It's a very inspirational, beautiful story of Dr. Sadao. his wife Hannah, okay, and along with him we would be talking about his father also, we would be talking about the army general also, okay, we will have these characters with us. But basically Dr. Sadao will be, yeah, the most important one more character is the enemy actually. Who is the enemy? Enemy will be the American soldier. He is actually the prisoner of war. The American soldier has come to Japan. He might have been imprisoned. And from there, he tried to run away. So when he was running away, he was shot from behind. So he has been shot at the back, but he kept on running. And then he fell into the sea. From the sea, the sea waves washed him ashore and he came near the house of Dr. Sadao. And now Dr. Sadao, you have to think, will Dr. Sadao save the enemy? Yes, he will save him. Because what will make him save the enemy? His ethics of a doctor. The ethics which he has learned as a doctor will make him save the enemy. But his patriotism will make him detached from the enemy as well. Okay, what will make him save the enemy? His ethics of being a doctor. But what will make him remain detached from the enemy? His patriotism. Should you love your enemy? If that will happen, then that would be your traitorhood. War is war. Everything is fair in war. Okay, Shita is saying love and war. Yeah, that is fine. But here, you are getting a very perfect example of love also. Okay, Dr. Sadao is giving you perfect example of love also. So when love is also based upon your ethics, your values, then that is also fine. Okay, otherwise it is sheer nonsense. Okay, The Enemy by Pearl S. Buck. So it's the time of the world war. Look at the text. If you don't have, you can simply listen to me. It's a time of world war. An American prisoner of war is washed ashore in a dying state and is found at the doorstep of a Japanese doctor. So American prisoner of war, POW. You understand what POW, prisoner of war. So who this POW is? American. And where has he come? To Japan. So he has come there in a dying state and is found at the doorstep of a Japanese doctor. Should he save him as a doctor or hand him over to the army as a patriot? What should he do? Both. He will do both of the things. As a doctor, he will save him. And as a patriot, he will try to hand him over to the army. And we will see whether the second part happens or not. If yes, how? If no, why? Okay. Dr. Sadao Hoki's house was built on a spot of the Japanese coast. I'll be speaking 3 or 4 lines and somebody will be asked to explain them. Is that clear? So listen very carefully to me. I will not repeat the lines. What I'm saying, after 3 or 4 lines, somebody will be asked to explain. Ready? So Dr. Sadao Hoki's house was built on a spot of the Japanese coast, COAST, where as a little boy, he had often played. Yes, Sohani, explain. Explain first line. There is only one Sohani. Come on, keep on sitting and speak. Okay, though I didn't listen what you were speaking, but I think it was correct. So let me also explain it again. Dr. Sadao Hoki's house was built upon the upon the Japanese coast. It was built along the Japanese coast. It was on a seashore. And he even had spent his childhood there only. Got it? The low square stone house was set upon rocks well above a narrow beach that was outlined with bent pines. Yes, Kshitij, explain. So what is your explanation? Sit down. So his house was made up of stones. And his house was upon a narrow beach. And that narrow beach had had bent pines. What are pines? Pine trees. So the beach was lined with pine trees. And along that beach was his house, which was made up of stone. Got it? And it was set upon rocks. Important point. His house was set upon, it was built upon the rocks and was made up of stones. And it was near a beach, and that beach was all full of or lined with pine trees. Location. Because you people are to answer the MCQs. So you have to be very careful about each and every word. Suppose the question comes that his house was made up of dash. The options are rocks, stone, pine, wood from pines. What's the answer? Stone. Suppose the question comes is his house was built dash upon the rocks near the beach, near the sea, near the pine trees. What's the answer? Upon the rocks. Though all the other options were also correct, but exactly his house was upon the rocks. So be very careful about very, very minor things. As a boy, Sadao had climbed the pines, supporting himself on his bare feet, as he had seen men do in the South Seas when they climbed for coconuts. Yes, you explain. Okay, sit down. Sadao, you know, Dr. Sadao always had an adventurous childhood. So when he was a child, he had seen men in the south climbing up the coconut trees. So he would imitate the same thing and he would climb up the pine trees with bare feet. Got it? So which trees he used to climb up? Pine trees. How would he climb up? With bare feet. Why would he climb up the bare feet? From where did the inspiration come? From the people in the south who would climb up the coconut trees. His father had taken him often to the islands of those seas, and never had he failed to say to the little brave boy at his side. So his father would often take him to those islands. Okay, usually fathers, people take the children to the multiplexes or what, but his father would take him to the islands and he would always tell him this thing. What? Let's see. Those islands yonder, means over there in the distance, those islands over there, they are the stepping stones to the future for Japan. So his father would take him to the islands and would tell him, like, those islands which are far off, they are the stepping stones to the future of Japan. Means our future depends upon those stepping stones. the future of the Japan. Because from the coastal areas, the defense system of the coastal areas is very, very important. Okay, you people must be knowing that all that our army is, maybe the Navy or the Air Force or the or military army. So all these armies, all the three segments of the army, they are continuously, always, continually defending the defending all areas, maybe coastal areas, maybe the land areas, or maybe the aerial areas. Okay, anyways, tomorrow we'll continue.